and I'm Patricia Duff, and welcome to The Common Good. Tonight, we've got an exciting panel, real experts to tell us what's happening on the ground at America's border and what we need to do there and about our immigration system more broadly. But before we get started, I'd like to acknowledge a few VIPs in the audience. They may be coming in over the next few minutes, but Ambassador Elizabeth Bagley, Ambassador Donald Blinken and his wonderful wife, Vera, that's our the parents of our Secretary of State, Gillian Sorensen, Ellen Chesler, Pete Granis, and we're happy to have a couple of experts on refugees and immigrants, Lisa Lehner and Maureen White, from our Honorary Advisory Board, Stan Schumann, some of our folks who've been great hosts, Jill Iskell, Jonathan Barnett, Tom Edelman, Fern Hurst, Sally Menard. We're always happy when we have members of the press on, current or lapsed. We honor the important role that the press plays in our democracy. So welcome to Mary Murray, Nancy Collins, Shirley Lord, Debbie Bancroft. And I want to say, since we're talking about immigration, we have some American Story contributors, Jill Lafer, Vera Blinken, and Kimbra Zolara, who's also our documentary film chair. At the Common Good, we really celebrate our nation as a nation of immigrants by telling the backstories of our members of our community and how their families ended up here in America. They're very real, quite wonderful American stories. We hope you will contribute your American backstory and read those who are already up on our website, thecommongoodus.org, my American story page. They're really wonderful. And hello to everyone live streaming us on Facebook as well. We look forward to having our audience members join the Q&A. So please raise your hand early. And now for our discussion. In March, Border Patrol officers saw almost 160,000 encounters with migrants at the southern border, the largest number of encounters since 2001. The individuals, families, and unaccompanied minors crossing into the U.S. come here seeking asylum and a better future for themselves and their loved ones, but they enter an overburdened system of shelters and courts which are struggling, often failing to cope with the sheer volume of new arrivals. And of course, not too long ago, you remember, Republicans and Democrats said they were incredibly close to a bipartisan comprehensive agreement on major immigration legislation that would deal with the 800,000 DACA children here, and many other immigration issues. In the meantime, candidate and then President Donald Trump found that immigration was one of his most powerful campaign issues, with nationalism and the border wall, a major promise that really energized his voters. And now we have President Biden, who seemed to stumble a bit in the first weeks of his presidency on the issue of immigrants at the southern border, particularly as children streamed over. But he seems intent on balancing humanitarian goals with immigration pressures. Can he do it without major political and electoral risk? How do we manage the border surges and respond to America's immigration crisis? Here to help us understand what's going on now and what we should be doing, we have Mayor Jim Darling, the mayor of McAllen, Texas. We're so happy to welcome you, Mayor. I had family living in McAllen for a long time, so they know you and some of your family, and they're some of them might even be on this Zoom. Jim has been a public servant doing admirably for decades, helping steer his city through three immigration surges. Under his leadership, McAllen has been recognized as one of the safest cities in the United States. We are very grateful to have him here to share his on-the-ground experience and insights. Welcome, Mayor.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
We also have policy and migration expert Andrew Selee. Andrew is one of the most respected experts on this issue. He is president of the Migration Policy Institute, one of the very few nonpartisan institutes working to improve immigration. We're very excited to hear his perspective on this complex issue. Secretary Jay Johnson and many others speak very highly of you, Andrew. Thanks for being here.
Thank you, Patricia. Great to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
Thank you. And we're also thrilled to be joined by New York Times national correspondent on immigration, Miriam Jordan. She also covered immigration at the Wall Street Journal. She's an extraordinary journalist. She's actually changed our national conversation about immigration with her superlative on-the-ground reporting on the complexities of immigration policies and the daily lives of immigrants in America. Miriam, welcome from Los Angeles.
Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you. And finally, to lead this conversation, we are really fortunate to have another terrific reporter, Dara Lind, the immigration reporter for ProPublica and co-host of the policy and politics podcast, The Weeds. Dara's policy scoops, big picture analyses, and human interest stories help her readers better understand immigration policies and their impact on everyday life. We are very glad to have you here to guide our conversation. And with that, I'm passing it over to you, Dara.
Great. Thank you so much, Patricia. And thanks to the Common Good for having us and hosting this. I'm super looking forward to having this conversation with some of the people I trust most to let me know what is really going on and what it means. So, you know, I think that there's, I'm sorry, my cat is, I think there's a, because there's been so much political rhetoric about the idea of whether or not what's happening at the border is a crisis, which is a term that can mean a lot of different things, there's been a little bit of obscuring of what is actually happening and the ways in which we can or can't say it's different from what we saw, you know, as recently as the first of the year or going back further to pre-COVID times to other times when the U.S., you know, border system has seemed under you know, stress. So I was hoping that we could maybe start with Miriam, followed by Mayor Darling, to just let us know, what have you been seeing on the ground recently? And to what extent does it strike you as something that's new or unprecedented versus what we might have expected coming into this season?
Well, I have spent a fair amount of time recently on the Arizona-Mexico border. And what struck me most is the diversity of the migrant population that is actually arriving in the country. I think that we have this image, and to a large extent, it is accurate, that mainly Central Americans and Mexicans are entering the country without authorization. But the fact is that we now have, I believe, large numbers of pandemic refugees who are arriving because they have nothing to lose. They're fleeing, conditions that have become intolerable. I mean, they cannot pay their bills. They cannot, you know, feed their families. And these are not the poorest of the poor. They seem to be kind of lower middle class, working class families from countries like India, Brazil, Venezuela, who have heard that it's easier to enter the United States under this new president without understanding the intricacies of policy. And here they are.
Yeah, at our port, it's still, we're kind of the direct way for Central Americans, but in our call this morning, was we have a weekly call with everybody on the border from El Paso to Brownsville, including Border Patrol and CBP. For the first time, they're seeing some Ecuadorians and Venezuelans come across at our point of crossing, which has been new, I would say, in the last couple of weeks. So that's interesting, but we're still primarily the Northern Triangle Central Americans coming across.
And in terms of, you know, not just kind of the diversity, but the numbers and capacity, what are each of you seeing in terms of, you know, trends or whether it appears to be outstripping, as, you know, we saw in February and March, the number of unaccompanied children coming kind of outstripping what the government's apparent capacity to take in and process them was?
We've been holding steady at our respite center, which is probably the most active respite center on the border now. We've been averaging about 1,800 a week. A large day would be 400. 3 months ago, we were averaging about 3,000 a week, and a lot of days, 500 or 600. So it's leveled off. And I think, of course, we only see that families are going to be released, which are the family members of the child of 6 years or younger. So we don't see the total numbers on the border, but they would reflect pretty much what's going on at the Anzaldúas crossing where most of the people cross. So we're seeing that. An interesting thing is our COVID numbers have leveled off at about 3%. And we do the testing at that point. We are the ones that do the testing for families that are released. And about 3% from about a 6 to 8% level. So we're seeing that level off too. And then the last thing, we're starting to, we had MPPs come across who were tested in Mexico. And of course the MPP numbers are going down drastically, but now we're seeing the most vulnerable numbers coming up, and those will be a little different. They have to, like MPPs, have to come across a bridge, and CBP will only process at our bridge about 40, and we have the major pedestrian bridge in the county. And Brownsville is leaving less than that. So we're not seeing the great surge that you would have by opening it up. So I think it's a strategy of the Biden administration to at least address the most vulnerable without opening it up. We also think that we would like to see non-essential travel open up. It's hurting our economy tremendously. We're down 50% in bridge crossings, about 50% essential and 50 non-essential. But we don't think that'll happen because he's gonna have a tough time keeping it relatively closed and keeping then letting non-essentials in. It's just a kind of a political juggling, if you will. So we're kind of caught in the middle of that on the border, which affects us in a way that people don't realize from an economic standpoint.
Mm-hmm. I want to highlight, you know, some of the terms you were mentioning, like MVPs, most vulnerables, you know, a reference to families with kids under six, because all of those reflect just the complexity that Miriam was talking about, you know, a few minutes ago, of just what actual border policy is right now and who is being allowed to, you know, stay and who is not. And so, Andrew, could you maybe walk us through, you know, who is having what happen to them, you know, once they cross into the U.S. and present themselves to Border Patrol agents or are apprehended?
Thank you, Dara. I mean, great to see you, by the way. And you know, we spend a lot of time trying to figure this out. And so I'm not sure I know the complete answer, but I can tell you, I think we've come, let me preface what I say. I think the assumption of the Trump administration was that the idea was to keep people out, right? I mean, it's really to see how you could diminish the numbers and prevent people from coming. The idea of the Biden administration has been, how do you manage this? And are there fair ways of doing, you know, some sort of screening to have a sense of who has, you know, real needs for protection of some sort? And we know what protection is in a second, but humanitarian protection of some sort at the border. And they're really feeling their way through this. And I think they've made choices along the way. They're not always consistent choices, but so it looks like a bit of a patchwork along the way, right? I mean, it would be hard to say exactly what's happening. So as near as we can tell, the ones who are definitely getting in are unaccompanied minors. They've been very clear, even though the courts eventually decided that the administration could return people, expel people to Mexico who are unaccompanied minors, they made the decision early in the Biden administration, they wouldn't do that. And so unaccompanied minors are being allowed in. Now, unaccompanied minors who are not from Mexico go through a much longer process in the immigration courts in the US. Those from Mexico are probably being returned fairly early on. It's not clear to me. I mean, there is an allowance to return Mexicans, and historically they've done that. That seems to be the case. With families, with adults, let's go to adults because that's the next easiest. With adults, they are trying to apply what's called Title 42 or the CDC rule saying that they can return people to Mexico. And at least for Mexicans and Central Americans, they are returning most of them to Mexico. And it's probably part of why we see the large number of Mexicans coming, because for the first time in many years, there's no real consequences for Mexicans who try and cross multiple times. We think adults are probably trying to cross multiple times in most cases. They tend to be more risk takers, more willing to do this. They don't have kids in tow. They're, you know, a little more willing to go through some real hardship in the process. There are some exceptions, however, which are, again, the Venezuelans and Brazilians and Cubans who Mexico will not take back usually. And not clear in all cases, but most cases they will not take back. And so seem to be coming into the U.S. Normally they would be deported back to their countries, but they seem to have made the decision not to do that. Certainly with Venezuelans and Cubans who are quite hard to deport because of humanitarian concerns. And so they give them a date in immigration court where they can decide whether or not they present asylum, petition for asylum. And then finally get to families. And families are always the most complicated in some ways. And families, they have been, theoretically have been sending back to Mexico under Title 42, the CDC rule. But in reality, in large parts of, particularly in the Rio Grande Valley, the numbers are just too much. The Mexican government made a decision not to take back more than a couple hundred a day, I believe it was, or a few hundred a day. And so in the end, large numbers have been staying in the US. Some of them have been given a court date. Some of them have been flown to San Diego or flown to El Paso and returned to Mexico. But it looks like last month, about 63% actually did come into the US. And that is true also of anyone that is not a Mexican or Central American national, because Mexico won't take them back as families. And then finally, and so families are really the really mixed case, because some families are being sent back, some families are being allowed in, families that belong to other nationalities are mostly being allowed in. And then finally, it seems like they're looking for some special cases of people who have real humanitarian needs. And that is really, it's a little bit of a, it's hard to tell what the criteria is. It's probably different from place to place, but it looks like an absence of a real functioning asylum system at the border, which we can talk about later, but there's not a functioning asylum system. They're trying to make some decisions about who might need, you know, particular humanitarian attention at the border and allowing those people in as well. But again, it's hard to talk about if there's a specific rule or a set of criteria around that. That does seem to be on very much an ad hoc basis. So did I confuse everyone thoroughly?
I think they stopped the San Diego flights about 3 weeks ago. So they're not.
they did. Okay. So you have much
like yesterday
fresher knowledge than I do.
But I want to go back a little bit, you know, in kind of looking a little more at some of the reasons that people are coming. I know Miriam, we got into that a little bit, but when Andrew was talking about the increase in single adults from Mexico, I was reminded of the piece that you wrote looking into the victims of the deadly crash in Imperial Valley, California earlier this year, and what, you know, those people's lives have revealed about that, this current, you know, trend in migration. So could you maybe talk a little bit about what you're seeing in terms of single adults from Mexico? And also just, you know, it's interesting because I think all of us have been following this issue long enough that we remember when that was the when a single adult from Mexico was the stereotypical border crosser. And now, it's only recently been displaced in the public understanding as kind of the middle figure, right at the time that it's increasing. So to what extent are you seeing a difference between who's coming now and who, you know, would have been coming 15, 20 years ago? And how does it fit into this kind of new picture of migration?
Right, that's a really good question, right? Because, you know, once upon a time, most border crossers were single males, the vast majority from Mexico. They were coming here because they wanted to, you know, make money to send back home to feed their families. But as the Mexican economy improved and Mexican families actually diminished in size, the fertility rate there fell to about 2.1, which was replacement level. We saw a decline that was also influenced by the increasing control of the border by cartels and the amount of money that it costs to come across. So those factors led to actually a negative immigration from Mexico for many years, just about what, from our 2008-2009 recession. And then we had this increase in the number of families in Central Americans in general fleeing poverty and gang violence. What I've detected now is, yes, this very large number of undocumented Mexican males, but and women and females actually, who, because the pandemic hit Mexico so hard, are now trying to get here again. Of course, that's coupled with the fact that we have Title 42 in place. They are well aware that if they, you know, cross the border and get caught, they won't be detained for any amount of time, or maybe a few hours, but basically they'll be questioned and they'll be dropped back on the other side. So there is an incentive for them to try multiple times until they can make it. And that's one thing our data does not show. It doesn't show how many people actually, you know, make it across because they're not apprehended. The only data we have that's kind of the proxy for who's trying to come is data for those encountered. So it's quite likely that many of these people, like the people who were in this SUV packed with 25 people when it was supposed to be carrying, what, 8? There are many people like them who are making it across. Unfortunately, you know, this ended in a tragedy. But among the people who were in this SUV were, you know, mothers from Mexican villages who had jobs in strawberry fields. There was a young boy who had a job in construction waiting for him in Utah, and on and on and on. I mean, pretty much everyone who's coming has a connection to this country, has a job. And in the case of Mexico, I sense that there is a combination of opportunity to come without being consequenced. If you don't make it, keep trying. And this new, you know, poverty or more difficulty earn a livelihood back home.
You know, it's interesting to hear the very, sophisticated sense of, oh, Title 42 is going to allow, you know, that it's totally consonant with how the actual policy is working out, that is allowing people to, you know, to be encouraged to try again and again, when compared to what you were saying earlier and what we've heard from, you know, from plenty of other folks, that there's this general free-floating perception that things are more open now, even among people who, for whom the policy is not any different than it was
right
a year ago. And so right. I was thinking that, like, that all of you could maybe talk from, and I know, you know, Mayor Darling, this is probably more from the perspective of your constituents who are, you know, US residents as anything, but what shapes the perception of whether it's possible to come to the US or not? And like, what, you know, I think that you know, obviously the Biden administration spent the first weeks of the administration working very hard to send the message to Central Americans that they shouldn't come. And, you know, without saying anything about whether or not that like works or doesn't work, what can we say about how people's, you know, what influences people's perceptions and makes it feel that it's possible for them to come?
So I think some of it is because there's no definitive policy, that even the ones coming from Central America that have kids over 6-7 years old and get sent back to Mexico are hoping that when the policy does get decided that they'll be ready to come. And I think that's what's happening. You know, some of the people we're talking about, and the mayor of Reynosa is a good friend of mine. They just had to build a new shelter for the people that are being sent back, is that they're not anxious to go back to Central America. They'll wait in Mexico now, even without a promise to a court hearing or appointment, to say, okay, well, let's wait and see what the administration does ultimately. And I think I think that's still sending people, at least from Central America, they're saying, okay, we're gonna try to come across. If we don't make it, we get sent back, we'll spend time in Mexico until it happens, until there is a policy. And I think that's what's driving a lot of people now.
My sense is that the coyotes are doing a much better job of marketing the opportunity to penetrate US soil or enter the United States than the Biden administration is doing dissuading folks from coming. It is what it is, I think. And in addition to the coyotes and what kind of messages they spread, most everyone has family or friends in the United States who, you know, are contributing to this by sharing stories about what they're reading. And even if the Biden administration has of late discourage folks from coming, it also did make a pretty big deal about the fact that it wanted to take a more humane approach. And humane and kind and compassionate mean come to a lot of people.
Mayor Darling, you know, I know that you, that like when you were talking about kind of the efforts in Reynosa and other places, kind of, you know, build capacity to welcome people, you know, to house people and welcome them in kind of on both sides of the border. You've described this as a crisis in Washington, not a crisis at the border or in border communities. Can you talk us through that a little bit? How are you seeing, you know, local communities step up and respond, and where do you think the failures in Washington are to take care of this you know, this phenomenon?
You know, we're part of the process. So we have a pretty close network of cities and NGOs that are handling what's brought to us, you know, and we're talking thousands and thousands. And what happens though is my daughter calls from California, said, you're all right, it's dangerous down there because of national media to fix, so we're being overrun, et cetera. So it's a crisis for Border Patrol every night at the river trying to handle this. But we're handling what's brought to us. And so our city is still one of we're the ninth safest city in the United States, according to FBI statistics. But we have people that are literally afraid to come here. We try to recruit for our new medical school doctors and the families who don't want to come here because it's too dangerous. So, you know, you can't pitch the whole situation with a broad brush. And so that's what we're saying. The crisis in Washington, I don't know how many, we had 19 U.S. senators in one meeting with us down here. I don't think that's happened ever. And it was Republicans, and they went on the river and gunboat, and they had their press conference and went back. And then we had a bunch of Democrats, House members primarily. They went to the detention center, had their press conference, and went back to Washington, and nobody's talking to each other. So I think that's a crisis in Washington, and certainly a crisis to the Border Patrol and to my mayor in Reynosa, Mexico, that's dealing with it. But we're handling it. We've handled it with COVID. We had 150 in quarantine, but we can handle more, and we're not releasing them to the rest of the country with COVID, and it's safe. Our cities are safe, and we're handling what's dealt to us. This is our third time. I've been mayor three times, and we've always done it. And there are different challenges each time. It's a little different each time, but that's our point, is you're really, not only are we being hurt economically from what's happening at our river, but the rest of the country's feelings about what's happening is hurting us economically too.
That seems like a different kind of perception versus reality problem, like one affecting how the rest of the U.S. understands what's going on in your community.
Yeah, absolutely, sure. It was interesting when President Trump was telling, you know, all the rapists and all those about Mexico. We're the largest sales tax collector in the state of Texas because 35% of our shoppers come from Mexico, and many of them the wealthy people from Monterey. Well, they refuse to come here. The governor of the state of Nuevo León said, don't go shop in McAllen, in response to President Trump. Don't go shop in McAllen, don't go any place in the United States, but particularly McAllen. And that's how directly it affects us. When a president says something and the governor of the state of Mexico says, don't go shopping in that city, that's pretty literal.
Andrew, you mentioned earlier, you know, the idea that there isn't a functioning asylum system at the border. Can you talk through what you think the bottlenecks in the system are? I mean, certainly for asylum seekers coming into the U.S., but if you want to kind of broaden that out to kind of the other choke points that you see that, you know, in theory would be reformed if Congress ever passed comprehensive immigration reform, but given the last 15 years have continued to just become a problem.
Yeah, I mean, first of all, let me agree with Mayor Darling that you know, that when something happens again and again, and this is it, we've seen a border crisis, as it's called in the media, in 2014 and 2016 and 2019 and 2021, you know, that is usually a sign that it is not, you know, that we're not paying attention to something broader, right? And, you know, it's not a border crisis. The mayor said it's a Washington crisis. I mean, first of all, it's a crisis of policy that we're not fixing. And it also represents a crisis in the region, right? I mean, we know that there is a crisis going on in Central America as well. Miriam's talked to that. I mean, but it's not just Central America. Central America is certainly where we see, you know, poverty, governance, climate issues, but also there's 4.5 million Venezuelans who have left their country and settled somewhere else in Latin America and the Caribbean, right? I mean, there's 100,000 Nicaraguans who've left since 2018 and moved to Costa Rica. I mean, there's a lot of crises going on of people being displaced where people are, you know, somewhere in Latin America and the Caribbean, and a lot of Central Americans that have ties to the U.S. that want to come here. But a few things we haven't done. I mean, there are almost no legal ways for Central Americans to come to the U.S. We know, so we've seen four crises here. One thing you would think we would do is create a legal pathway for Central Americans to come as an alternative to hiring a coyote and coming. We have about 250,000 Mexicans who come every year and work as temporary agriculture and non-agricultural workers. The equivalent number from Central America is between 5,000 and 8,000, depending on the year. That's the number of visas that Central Americans get from Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador to come and work. So there's no alternative legal line to get into for Central Americans. We created one for Mexicans largely by chance, because US employers started looking to Mexico, particularly for agricultural work. And as there are fewer undocumented people actually in the US, they started looking to Mexico. And so it created a line that Mexicans can get into every year if they want to come to the US without having to hop over the border fence. Now we are starting to see a change this year. We don't know if that's because how bad things were in Mexico last year. We are seeing a large number of Mexicans, but that's atypical, as Miriam said. You know, it's been Mexican numbers have been going down for a long time. So one, there's no legal line to get into. Mexicans also have a lot of permanent residents and citizens who can ask for family reunification, can request family members. So there are tens of thousands of Mexicans who come to the US every year legally, also through the family streams. There's much less of that from Central America because these are less established communities. So simply no legal lines to get into. Secondly, we have an asylum system that is broken. It's been broken for a while, but the last administration kind of took a bat to it and finished off what was left of it. The current administration, I think, is trying to pick up the shards, but they're still trying to figure out how to put them back together and maybe want to create a different, you know, a different instrument than was there before. There is a way of doing this right now. Everyone who's asked for asylum goes into the immigration court system, which has about 1.3 million cases pending and takes 3 to 4 years. That's obviously doesn't work at the border, right? I mean, if you say to someone, oh, you're fleeing for your life, sign up here, apply here, and in 3 or 4 years, we'll tell you whether we give you protection or not. That's not a functional system. I mean, it's neither functional for the person who has a real claim who needs protection, nor is it obviously, and it also creates a perverse incentive for people who may have weaker claims to try and make a strong claim because they know they'll be able to stay in the country 3 or 4 years. So we need a system that is fair, efficient, errs on the side of giving people protection, but also, you know, makes a decision in months and not years. There's a way of doing this. My colleague Doris Meisner has talked about this. I think the administration is working on something like this, although I'm not completely sure, but where you could actually have asylum officers make a decision on cases and not send them to the courts. And that would allow a decision within months and not years. It's not perfect, but at least it would be a more efficient system and probably a fairer system than what we have now. And you know, if we could create those two things, one, a legal line for people to get into, and two, a system of protection that actually works, I think we'd start to see the numbers go down very quickly. And what enforcement would do, right now we were trying to stop everything through enforcement, either Mexican enforcement at their southern border or US enforcement at our border. And what that, it never quite works, and there end up being lots of exceptions. What it would do if you had legal pathways and protection pathways is a lot of people, instead of paying a smuggler $6,000 or $8,000 and risking their lives, would much rather get in a legal line or much rather apply for protection. People would be looking for these alternatives. We could also be using our refugee system to identify people in their countries before they flee. We could be looking at how to protect people who are fleeing from violence in their own countries. And there's a lot of things we could do under protection. So, you know, part of the failure is we have not gotten creative. And every time there is a crisis, we dub it a new border crisis rather than a Washington crisis. And we throw our hands in the air and say, this is something we've never seen before. But, you know, with all the differences that there are each time, it is a permutation on what we saw 2 or 3 years earlier.
You know, every time I hear about the immigration court backlog, I think about just how long this has been going on because, you know, there have been stories about the unprecedented backlog in US immigration courts since the number was much, much lower, like 10, 15 years ago. And so I'm wondering, you know, now that we have something of a, you know, it's been broken for a while, although the ways in which it's been broken have kind of, you know, the factors leading to the increase in the backlog have changed. We do have a certain amount of, you know, of experience kind of watching people try to go through this very slow and backlogged system. And, you know, I'm wondering, you know, first of all, Miriam, what you've seen in talking to folks who are kind of languishing in this process, what that does for their experience in the US. And, you know, also if all of you could maybe talk a little bit about because this has been an issue for so long, there's this kind of bipartisan-ish idea that if you throw enough money at the court system, that everything will improve. And I'm wondering if the problems that, you know, you folks have seen with the system are things that could be fixed with, you know, a bigger increase in money and therefore the more efficient administration of justice, or if you've seen that the two of those don't necessarily go together.
Right. So, I mean, I have to say that this problem is one that vexes me tremendously, especially when I talk to folks from Africa, because I've spoken with, you know, people who have managed to get to the United States, individuals who were fleeing political persecution, left their families behind, and are now stuck in this backlog. And unlike the families that have crossed the border and applied for asylum and are waiting and waiting and waiting, they're separated from their families. And for this gentleman, I believe, like, you know, some of these thugs and or came to his house to like throw boiled water on his child's face. And he's in New York, has an asylum case, he's probably going to win it, but he can't legally bring his daughter and wife to the United States until his case comes to completion. And that to me is emblematic of how, you know, how broken this system is. And yes, there are many folks who have very weak claims or no claims at all who have used the system to receive work permits. Or because, right, there's no line or there's, you know, it's so inefficient or what have you. And yeah, their cases are clogging the courts.
Andrew, and, you know, perhaps Mayor Darling, just because I know that the, you know, there was some attention in 2019 to the institution of tent courts. Near where you were, which was kind of the maximum of this idea that the quicker administration of justice would be better. I was wondering if maybe you could also talk some about, you know, whether quicker really, you know, whether you think that a more efficient, quicker court process would be sufficient here.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things we did, we worked with the Mexican consulate in on a Trimexa, which was a Central American Mexico plan to take the United States and help where Mexico would help do that. Some of the issues were establishing a criminal justice system back in Central America, but by also doing hearings back there in Central America, so that if you got it, you didn't pay the cartels, you flew for $2,000 to wherever you're going, as opposed to a cartel. And if you didn't, don't come, because you would be deported. And it's much, much difficult, obviously, with children to come across and escape apprehension. And so that didn't go over well, but I mean, there was one with, it was education, healthcare, criminal justice, and economic development prongs to that in Washington. That was, I don't know if it was too complicated or too expensive. We spent a billion dollars since that time trying to do something about it. But it seemed to me that there's relatively, if you got the people that want to work in those countries, and we have consulate offices, et cetera, that may alleviate some. And then you have boots on the ground in Central America actually seeing what's going on and what works and what doesn't. And but that seems to be too much of a simple process to try it.
The other thing, I think it is hard to fix the asylum system at the border using the immigration court system. I mean, it is, you know, Dara, as you said, it's just been a long road of, you know, we talk about sort of how do you fix it, and it keeps growing and growing. With asylum applications, someone who flies in from Africa or from Venezuela and, you know, gets in on a tourist visa and then applies for asylum, we allow asylum officers to make the decision, right? They do have a right of appeal to the immigrant, you know, beyond this, to the appeals courts, the immigration system, but they don't go into the immigration court system as a first step here. And it, you know, the reason it is different at the border is that people are in removal hearings, right? I mean, you're entering in, you've been apprehended, and therefore you are, you know, you're applying for asylum, but you already are, you need relief from the court because you're in removal proceedings. If we would change that, and you need a rule to change this, and rules are hard to change in the US government, and you have to resource it, you could also have asylum officers make the decision. And they tend to be more consistent than the courts are as well. I mean, there's a lot of advantages. I don't think you want to make it express. I mean, express asylum is not fair asylum either. And so, you know, there is that balance between being efficient and at the same time giving people enough time that they can get legal counsel, that they can, you know, they can prepare their case, they can get documents from their home country if they don't have them with them. You know, you have to have some time in the process. And at the same time, not letting it languish and go on so long that the decisions aren't made in real time. You know, I mean, I think that's it. Legal counsel is a really good idea. I mean, there's a lot of great organizations doing this. There's some cities that help provide legal counsel to people in asylum proceedings. It's actually good both for people who have really strong cases, but it's also sometimes good with people who don't have strong cases and letting them know they don't have a strong case. You know, it's not actually, I mean, the sort of fear is if you give everyone legal counsel, suddenly everyone's going to win their asylum cases. It doesn't really work out that way. I mean, what actually happens is also people who don't have strong cases have an attorney who says, look, I'm willing to do this, but, you know, let me tell you, your chances aren't good. And then I think the question becomes, do we offer people anything as an off-ramp? And, you know, that's a conversation we've never had, but it's worth thinking about, right? Is if someone says, I don't have a strong case, you know, I'm going to go back to my home country. Do we think about reintegration services in any way? Do we make people's return slightly more humane in a way that allows them? And look, there's no good way to do a deportation. I mean, let's not sugarcoat it too much. I mean, if you're going to deport someone, that is a life-wrenching decision. But if that's going to happen anyway to lots of people, and it will, I mean, you know, that is part of keeping a border where there is some control, you know, and deterring people who are not fleeing for their lives from coming to the border and making sure people use legal pathways that hopefully we're creating. You know, can you do a deportation that's slightly more humane, that gives people some option on the other end to figure out how they're going to get reinserted in the labor market, right? And so, I mean, I think that if we could start thinking about this holistically, I think we can come up with a solution that is, you know, both firm, because I think the American public expects there to be a sense of control at the border, right? And at the same time, humane and treats people with dignity, make sure we live up to our obligations to protect people that are running for their lives, and protects, you know, and offers people legal options as an alternative to a dangerous journey, right? Not everyone that wants to come can, you know, everyone can get in the line. Not everyone will necessarily get a visa, but there's a line to get into, you know, that gives people an opportunity. We can be both firm and at the same time humane. And I think that's the challenge that we haven't embraced before. I do have a sense the Biden administration is trying to figure this out, but in the interim, there's a bit of, you know, there is a sort of sense of chaos as the goalposts keep moving here. And it is a moment where this feels a little bit fluffy. And let me throw out one more thing. I know you're probably headed here sooner or later, Dara, but there is, you know, I think the other reason why getting this right matters is it poisons whenever there's a perception of a border crisis. And again, I will agree with the mayor. I don't think it's a border crisis. I think it's a Washington, D.C. crisis. And I assume this is someone in Washington, D.C. You know, I think it is a D.C. crisis, not a border. But every time there's a perception of a border crisis, it poisons our politics. And that does damage to other conversations we're having around immigration. And so there is a real need to get this right in a way that balances equities, makes sure there's a sense of real control at the border, and at the same time treats people fairly, treats people with dignity. You know, and that's a tough balance to get, but that's what we should do.
All right. And with that, I think we've given good ground and good footing on what's happening at present, and given you guys plenty of options for things, you know, for more ideas to poke at during Q&A. So I'll turn it back over to Patricia. Patricia, you could unmute.
Got it. Thank you. That was a terrific, terrific conversation, all of you. And we've got quite a few questions on the boards. I'm gonna start with, we'll start with Katarina Van Otto, a filmmaker, and then go to NBC's Mary Murray, which I'll ask her question, and then Ambassador Bagley, and move down the line. We've got a bunch of questions. So, Katarina.
Yes, hi. Hi. Thank you for this wonderful topic and the great talk. So I'm curious, and I'm wondering a little bit also about the Syrian refugee crisis, which we haven't addressed yet this afternoon. Don't you think that America puts out a message to countries across the world that it is a country of immigrants and refugees, Yet in practical terms, America often falls short of this rhetoric. What do you see as a realistic and morally appropriate number of refugees that should enter this country each year? And what are the solutions you'd like to see implemented?
Dara, do you want to see?
I'm going to put Andrew on the spot as probably the one person who is equipped to speak to the kind of normative, what should the system be side of this? But just to kind of make a couple of points about how, you know, about the kind of relationship between refugee resettlement as a message the US sends to the rest of the world and refugee resettlement as policy. You know, we saw this tension a couple of weeks ago when the Biden administration announced, you know, after initially saying it was not raising the refugee cap for this fiscal year, that they were, and were raising it to a level that they, that like President Biden openly said the US was not going to hit. That was partially a message, if an ambivalent one, about, you know, this, the importance of this and US leadership in the world, but it was also partly a way to ramp up the capacity because the because refugee resettlement in the US is an infrastructure that has been really starved for resources for the last 4 years, as there was something of a vicious cycle of fewer refugees being allowed in, meaning that the nonprofit organizations responsible for resettling them got less funding, had to make cuts, had less capacity to take in refugees the next year. So there's this normative, global, foreign policy-centric discussion about America's role in the world and the message we send, but there's also a very bread and butter set of concerns about if the Biden administration were to, you know, continue to raise the refugee ceiling, how close would it actually come in practice to meeting the goals that it sets for itself? And what message does that send if the government is making commitments that it isn't then actually keeping?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a huge challenge between, I mean, I think, first of all, your premise is correct. I mean, I think the world has looked at us recently as not living up to our obligations, that we have a rhetoric of being a country that's open to immigrants, but we're actually deeply ambivalent about it, have been reluctant to share our burden. We were at one point the largest resettler of refugees in the world, and we've become, you know, the Canadians are beating us out at this. Not only that, by the way, also on legal pathways from Central America, as a Guatemalan colleague told me the other day, the Canadians take five times as many temporary workers from Guatemala as the United States. You know, so there really is a sense in that we haven't, you know, we're not living up to our obligations. You know, I think the Biden administration has set an ambitious cap. As Dara says, it's going to take time to get there. There's a lot of bipartisan support still, and a lot of local support above all else. I mean, you know, it's bipartisan, but it's also deep and local around the US on refugee resettlement. And it's worth seeing what the market will bear. I mean, it's worth over time, you know, in all of these policies, the question is, how can you do, you know, how close can you get to an ideal you have without losing, you know, without losing public support? Because public support matters, right, for something to be self-generating. And I think the same thing is true on asylum, right? I mean, we need to reopen our asylum system, you know, hopefully a renewed, better asylum system. But, you know, how far do you get, you know, between asylum and refugees, how far can you go in attending some of these humanitarian needs without losing public support? Can you expand gradually over time in ways that allow, you know, the demand to build up and public support to drive it rather than getting ahead of the public? These are all tough decisions, right? These are tough leadership decisions. And also, can you do things around legal pathways that aren't refugees, right? I mean, can you find people who are, have unique talents out there which the US needs and bring them in not as refugees, but as, you know, through our legal visa system, for example? I mean, that's a huge opportunity. You know, can we bring in people, you know, many people in Central America don't want to apply for asylum. They'd rather work in agriculture for the summer and make a few dollars for 6 months and go back. Can we do that? I mean, can we be creative in creating those other legal pathways for people beyond refugee and asylum as well? And I think that gets to a larger debate around US immigration policy we need to attend to. But I think it is important, you know, when policymakers think about this, you want to design an ideal system, but you also don't want to get so far ahead of the public that you design something that doesn't have broad public support. And the refugee system has been great in large part because there still is this local demand. You know, the more you can let that drive the buildup, the better.
Okay, I'm gonna quickly read this question from Mary Murray of NBC News, who's having a little trouble connecting by audio. The Biden administration has insisted that one of the key initiatives to curbing informal migration is to make it easier for migrants to apply for asylum in their home countries instead of making the dangerous journey to the US. According to the UN, a total of 487 people applied for refugee status in Guatemala in all of 2020. Considering that 172,000 migrants came to the US in March alone, the fact that there are no consulates outside the Guatemalan capital, the idea that migrants will be applying for asylum in their home county seems far-fetched. Do you see any way for this to become a real option? I don't know who you think should take that, Dara.
I want to make sure that we're talking about the same thing here, because when we're talking about people applying for asylum in Guatemala, those are non-Guatemalans who have come to Guatemala and decided to seek asylum there. What the Biden administration is proposing, which is a continuation and expansion of something that the Obama administration was pushing, or rather that Joe Biden was pushing when he was vice president, and the point person on this issue, is that there's going to be expanded in-country processing for people to come to the US. So the US, in presumably in collaboration with the UN Refugee Agency, which is what does a lot of the kind of intake for refugee processing abroad, would be building out its own infrastructure. We've already seen them trying to kind of make a head start on this by restarting what's called the Central American Minors Program, which was an Obama era initiative to allow children in Guatemala, Honduras, and El Salvador who had parents in the US to apply for legal status and come rather than coming to the US as unaccompanied children. The question of whether it works is still a viable question, because kind of by definition, someone who feels urgently that they need to flee their home country because their life is in peril may not feel safe sticking around to see what the US consulate or the UNHCR rep has to say. But that's and there are, of course, you know, really urgent questions about what's the timetable for this and what is the solution in the meantime. But when the Biden administration talks about applying, you know, in people's home countries, that's what they mean. And it would be, you know, you wouldn't necessarily have to be building up capacity of the Guatemalan government to do that. There is a kind of longer term idea that people should be able to apply for asylum closer to home, you know, in Guatemala or in Mexico, but that is as much about the, you know, strength of governance and strength of the rule of law in those countries as it is the strength of their asylum systems. You know, when you talk to refugees from people who fled Central America because they, you know, and then found out in Mexico or felt in Mexico that the gang that was pursuing them was following them, or found out after they left that somebody had come to their sister's house who was living in Mexico and threatened her, you don't necessarily get the sense that those people would be comfortable staying in another country where they didn't feel that the rule of law was strong enough to guarantee their safety.
Can I jump in quickly on this? I mean, I think the way we have to think about this is layered, right? It's layered protection systems. And so first option is, how do we help countries build up in-country protection systems? There are some NGOs like Cristo Sal in El Salvador, Honduras that do this very well, but on a small basis. You know, but how do you protect people? There are laws in a couple of the countries, in El Salvador and Mexico, to protect people who are displaced internally. Honduras is debating one. You know, how do we protect people where they live? You know, first option. For some people, that's not an option, right? I mean, because there is no safe space in their country. So can we identify some people ahead of time, remove them either through the Central American Minors Program, or there's something else called the Protection Transfer Arrangement, where people are sent to Costa Rica while the UN Refugee Agency and another government looks at their case and then resettles them somewhere else in the world. So, but again, you can't scale these things up infinitely, right? I mean, you can scale them up a bit, but there are logistical limits to how big you can make this. Then there's Mexico and Costa Rica. Mexico's on path to have about 80,000 asylum applications this year, if current rates continue. Costa Rica, about 25,000. You know, they're doing a lot of work, and most people seem to be staying in those countries that apply for asylum. So what can we do to help them both process quicker and more efficiently, and then resettle people so they have dignified lives if they choose to stay as refugees in those countries, right? And transition to be permanent residents. And then finally, there's our asylum system, right? So, I mean, almost thinking, and that should be the last resort. It should be there, but we should assume that, you know, someone who's moved, you know, 2,000 miles to ask for protection at the US border, you know, that we failed in other ways to protect them before they got there, right? And so we should be looking at those other ways. And by the way, I agree with you. I mean, on Guatemala, I mean, having gone through Guatemala, tried to cross it a few times. I mean, you know, there are people who live 8, 10, 12 hours away in what looks like a small country, but live away from the capital, for whom it is, you know, not an incentive. So one of the questions, even if you're going to identify people across the country who might need protection, is you have to have a network of people that do this. And if you're going to sign up people for a temporary worker program, you need to have places that are not just in the capital to do this. You actually have to begin having a presence on the ground further beyond. So, yes.
Okay, I'm going to go to Maury Sonnenberg, then Ambassador Bagley, then Sean Daniel and Maureen White. And we still have questions after that. Let's hope we get through.
You see me all right?
Yes.
All right. I'd like to take this to another area. That's the question of the drug trade. And it's a just juxtaposition towards this. And also the question of the number of people who are on the border patrol. It's my understanding there may be 600 along that whole border. I said, we need at least three times more, I would say. Secondly, on the question of trucking, one of the things that came up earlier was this horrible incident of this SUV with these people who died. Where are we looking into protecting, one, these people? Number two, where are we looking about the advent and the increase of crime that's coming along with this? By crime, I mean drug dealing, etc.
Hey, Dara, who's best to answer?
Yeah, on the drug stuff, and maybe Mayor Darling is best for that. But I am not sure where you're getting the idea that there are only 600 agents on the border.
I'll tell you where. It was a journalist on NBC, actually, about a week or two ago.
Yeah, that is not, that's the kind of top line staffing of Border Patrol is absolute, is, you know, tripled, if not more so, over the last 15, 20 years. And, you know, just quickly Googling, I can't tell you how many are on the front line at any given time, but Border Patrol, which is responsible solely for, you know, for between ports of entry, so doing the kind of border enforcement that we're talking about, employs, you know, almost 20,000 agents, and I'm pretty sure that a substantial number of those are doing frontline U.S.-Mexican border interdiction. So
I was just talking about actually out there walking, going across the border with their trucks or whatever. I wasn't talking about the whole system.
I'm going to try to get a better number for you, but I'm gonna ask what his experience is in terms of drugs and crime.
Mayor Darling, do you want to add to that?
Well, I mean, we're seeing a lot more activity with stash houses, et cetera, on the border, and the drug activity as Border Patrol gets more and more involved in asylum seekers, there's more opportunity to smuggle drugs. And when there's much more opportunity, there's also more intervention in smuggling drugs. So all those numbers are up. And I guess the question is, just like Mexican male nationals are coming across, how many are getting across, how many drugs are getting across. We've seen the activity in Falfurrias, which is the northern checkpoint, the 50-mile checkpoint, seeing much more drug activity and illegal alien activity apprehension in those areas. And I think it goes hand in hand as Border Patrol has to do other things than traditional border protection issues, you're gonna see much more activity in those areas.
I would just like to point out one thing on the drug front, and that is, I don't have numbers to offer, but I do know that the majority of drugs that are entering this country are actually coming through the ports of entry. They're coming tucked in trucks. They're coming, you know, mixed in with fruits and other products. So they aren't necessarily coming across where the migrants are coming across, although some migrants are being enlisted by cartels to carry methamphetamine and other drugs in backpacks and in other ways in exchange for crossing. It's kind of like, you know, it's the price that they pay.
Yeah, and thanks to Colorado, there's very little marijuana smuggling now at the border.
Okay, great. So let's go to Ambassador Begley, then Sean Daniel, then Maureen White. Still more after that.
Okay, thanks, Patricia. Can you hear me?
Perfectly.
Okay. I think the question I wanted to ask is kind of a basic question, i.e., what exactly is the difference, especially in the legal system, between asylum seekers and refugees who I know are protected by international law, and migrants who I'm assuming are the ones that come over from Mexico and go back. And I thought that there was an asylum law passed years ago with regard to the Northern Triangle asylum seekers. So I just wanted some, you know, clarification on those three categories. Thanks.
Okay, Dara, who do you think we should ask to answer that?
I could offer, just as a general disambiguation, migrants is often used, as you implied, to refer to people who aren't, who don't have humanitarian claims. That can be really tricky because, you know, as Miriam has made very clear, a lot of these people are somewhere between what you would consider the stereotypical like asylum seeker, their government said they would kill them because of their religion or whatever, and, you know, purely economic migrants. They might be leaving for economic reasons, but because they can't feed their families, so it feels much more pressing to them, or there might be other factors in play. So it can get very tricky. Because refugee is a recognized term under international law and refers specifically to someone who another government has found to be a refugee, to be deserving of humanitarian protection, people often use asylum seekers to refer to people who have, you know, who have applied for humanitarian protection or who that's the reason they're coming to a country, but haven't necessarily, you know, gone through that process yet. The technical government term for someone who's received asylum is an asylee. But they could also, they at that point, you know, have been classified as a refugee under international law. So these are nomenclature issues. And so it really does depend on, to a certain extent, what the definition of the person using them is. But that should help as far as, you know, what we're talking about in this context, understand why different terms are popping up in different places.
And is there an asylum law? Was there an asylum law with regard to the Northern Triangle? Seemed to me that there was at some point.
So it's ironic because the asylum system that we have right now was in large part designed in response to the Reagan administration treating Central America differently on asylum issues. But so there was kind of there was a major legal sediment that applied to Central Americans in that regard. But U.S. asylum law generally doesn't make any distinctions in terms of where someone has come from. The distinctions are why they're being persecuted, and as Andrew discussed earlier, whether they come to the U.S. on a visa and then seek asylum, or whether they cross without papers and then present themselves to Border Patrol and say they're seeking asylum.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sean Daniel, do you have a question or does somebody want to add to that? Otherwise, we'll go to Sean and then Maureen, or did we lose Sean? Okay, we lost Sean. How about Maureen White? Do you want to go ahead and ask your question? Now, this is somebody who knows about refugees.
Thank you for Patricia. And I have to first begin by applauding you for taking on this subject and for bringing together such a great panel. It is very complicated, as the conversation we have had already indicates. As Elizabeth's question also highlights, there is a lot of misunderstanding about the nomenclature surrounding these issues, which lead many, many people who oppose the idea of letting in more people, whether it's economic migrants, temporary status applicants, or refugees, to use the confusion to manipulate the situation and to create a sense of crisis. So it's, I mean, it's worth putting some historic context on this. This is not something new. It did not happen just with Joe Biden or with Donald Trump or with Barack Obama. It's been going on for something like at least 50 years. And there's many a person who came, president who came in, whether it was Jimmy Carter or George Herbert Walker Bush or Bill Clinton, who campaigned on ending whatever problems we were facing with refugees at that time. And all three of them met their match in a backlash, some of it legitimate, and some of it certainly fomented and fostered by those who wanted to exploit the crisis of the time to put a stop on a lot of this immigration. So history is not on our side and time is not on our side. And as much as the Biden administration wants to do the right thing, they actually have a very, very delicate balancing act to do while they try to help those most in need and while they try to rebuild the situation. So that brings me to a couple of questions. One of which is that we rely on good information. And that's why having Andrew Selee in the Migration Policy Institute here is always the gold star source of information, which is accurate, balanced, nonpartisan, and extremely constructive. But turning to Miriam, I have a question related to one of the facts that you threw out, which was that you see an increasingly diverse population coming across. And you used, in fact, the phrase pandemic refugees. Now, I don't know whether that's 3% of the population coming across, 20% of the population, or 60% of the population, but I could very easily see a Fox News headline saying wealthy pandemic refugees are crowding the asylum system. So again, you know, we want to make sure that we give the Biden administration as much time as it needs, we give the NGOs, we give the research organizations as much time as they need to get things right without creating red flags, which the opponents could attack. But I also want to go back to something that Andrew did say about the importance of looking at this in a much more complex and multi-layered way. And again, it's hard to explain that there have to be multiple pathways to entrance in the United States. And that we have to go through a public education process to explain to people that there are many, many people who can come to the United States temporarily or long-term who would perform a legitimate function in our economy and in our political society. So how do you see, this is a probably too big a question to answer in one way or one simple way, but there's a big public education problem ahead of us to deal with the misinformation and to counteract the distortions. How do you see the role of the institutions, whether it's the New York Times or the Migration Policy Institute or brave mayors on the border? How do you see this public education process evolving?
I know we're over time, so do your best here because we're going to have to let everyone go in a moment, but who wants to start that? Mayor Darling?
Yeah, I can, if Mayor Darling, if you want to, you're welcome to. I have one brief thought on some of this, but.
Well, and I think Maureen specifically referenced Miriam. I don't know if she's still on even.
I'm here, yeah. It's a great question. I don't really have an answer. You know, yes, I know that I have a very big responsibility to report the facts and to report stories in a way that is neutral and that to a large extent lets readers come to their own conclusions. I don't think it's my role to, you know, to say the Biden administration is doing a good job. And I know you're not suggesting that, Maureen, but it's really tough. I mean, it's been very challenging being a New York Times reporter on this issue of late, because I do feel that the stories are being kind of dissected by people on both sides of the immigration agenda. And fortunately, this is a very polarized country. That doesn't really answer your question. It's just, you know, it is what it is. My job is to report the truth. And yes, I have to be careful about the language that I use. And, you know, I do make certain decisions about stories that I write based on my own views as a human being and, you know, and what I think our country stands for. And yes, what I believe its, you know, its role should be and how it should address these issues. But it's tricky. Sorry, I don't know if that answers your question.
I will say that, you know, I've been doing this for much less time than Miriam has, but even in the years that I've been reporting on this, I've learned that if I make myself responsible for how the public thinks or understands something, I will drive myself off up a wall, because there's just too many times that you try to get something across and you don't feel that people are listening. And conversely, there are so many times when even if you act with all, you know, that even when you work as hard as possible to clarify what you're saying and to prevent against its like misuse by political actors, that happens anyway. I can only imagine it's much worse at the New York Times. But you know, at a certain point, there has to be an ecosystem for discussing these things that doesn't rely entirely on reporters to tell people not just what's going on, but also how to think about it.
Yeah. Go ahead, Mayor.
Yeah, my experience, you know, I've probably been interviewed, I would say 80 times since this all happened, and just trying to tell our story. And they're not interested, depending whether, you know, they're liberal or conservative, they just aren't interested. I do NPR because they do the whole interview. And I've watched my interviews on and say, wow, did they pull that out of context? And it just, I don't know where the public goes for the real truth in this country. I try to watch it at night, things that don't affect the border, but up north. And I don't know where to get my information. I just have to tell you that. It's pretty sad.
Immigration often becomes shorthand for other debates that are going on in American society, right? And so a lot of things are not the quiet, you know, reasonable conversations that should be had, but they're ticking buttons, they're pressing buttons that are about something else. But I think within that, you know, our obligation is to try and be as accurate as we can, to tell the story as we can, and also get, you know, to have the conversations, the reasonable conversations that bring people together of goodwill who may disagree with each other, right? I mean, who may see things very differently, but try and get them to reach some common ground. I mean, in the end, we need an immigration system that has credibility within the American public, right? I mean, we want an immigration system that follows international law. We want an international system that treats people with dignity, you know, finding, squaring, you know, but within that, reasonable people can actually disagree about what the contours of this are. And you know, I think one of the challenges here is, how do you get beyond people's symbolic buttons and have those rational conversations where people can feel free to disagree and maybe at some point reach some clarity on a way forward?
Well, we like the idea of ending on finding common ground. And this was really important. And you were just a wonderful, wonderful, outstanding panel. Great question. So thank you so much, Dara, Mayor Darling, Andrew, and Miriam. It was a pleasure having you. Thank you for staying over time. And I hope we can come back and discuss this more with perhaps a little more progress with this administration. So thank you so much. I know, Mayor Darling, there's some people on the call who want to just say hello if you have a minute to stay on. Otherwise, thank you all. I'm sorry we didn't get to all the questions today. Please join us. There's going to be a, you know, mayoral debate later tonight. You should watch it at 7:00. And next week, we've got the rise and threat of the right-wing domestic terror with Jay Johnson, FBI agent Michael German, ADL chief Jonathan Greenblatt, and Professor Robert Pape, and a lot of other great things coming up. So please join us. Please come back. Thank you so much.